We are geared up and ready to be watching semi-finals number two. I'm Grubby, and with me is Tetcher from the UK, and we're going to be casting these games. Next coming up, 4K MMR average versus Ready, Able, and Willing.
Yep, and they appear to have swapped themselves around in terms of from the brackets, which is Ready, Able, Willing on the left, just in case you hadn't set that up in terms of your display.
Feels bad, man.
For the stream. Nice. But we're getting into the first draft here. It is going to be Tomb of the Spider Queen with 4K MMR average as the first team to ban, and they're banning Mazebo.
Okay, Mazebo ban on Tomb of the Spider Queen.
Yep, you gotta get rid of the spiders. It's like, this map has too many spiders. Let's get rid of at least a couple. And a Ragnaros first pick by 4K MMR average.
YellowFlash on the Ragnaros again. One of his last opportunities, as we've just seen a patch note.
I'm reading them as we speak.
Yeah.
Nerfs to Q and nerfs to R.
Let's see. His auto attack damage goes down by 5%, almost. 4.5%. And Power Sulfurous goes down by 4.5%. Sulfurous Smash increase in cooldown from 60 to 80 seconds. And Resilient Flame only procs once every 15 seconds instead of every 10. And the armor will be 40 instead of 50. I think it's all very fair. I think it really hits the spot. Yeah. Resilient Flame was still too good. It's very difficult to stun someone and be like, okay, in the next 10 seconds we'll get him again. 15 is fair. And really minor damage nerfs. And then the Sephira Smash really was too often. This is what he was meant to be, in my opinion. There's more changes and we'll maybe look at it together. If if we have a chance, but for now, of course, the draft is well underway. Patch notes neither here nor there yet.
Indeed, they shall be coming later. So for now, we already mentioned Rag as the first pick, responded by Greymane Arthas. Very scary combination there. Mafurion has now been picked up by 4K MMR average. They still need their third pick though. Hovering over that, I wouldn't be surprised to see a damage dealer coming in for them here, or maybe they already have Rags as solo laners, so they don't need that. So
they could do ETC. I know it's a little bit strange and unusual, but he does get picked almost every time in the first or second rotation, so I guess not that strange.
Yeah. It's true, but at least we quote his song lyrics. That's all good.
If it's not ETC, who could it be?
Valor is open, Zebo's banned out, Gul'dan open, very nice choice there. Combo as well with Mafurion with Ragnaros. Pretty strong.
ETC ban would be a decent obvious one. Another one possibly Leoric. Leoric does pretty okay against Arthas, as Arthas has no escape and a pretty decent hero, decent health pool to drain. But you would probably not go Leoric when you have Ragnaros already, as they're both solo laners.
Yeah, so they'll probably leave that. So, bans-wise, ETC, Muradin. Looks like they're going to hover over Muradin and maybe let ETC through, or pick it up for themselves on the side of Ready, Able, Willing.
Oh, of course. I don't see that hover again. It's so weird.
Yeah, I have the power.
How did you do it?
I don't know. I haven't done any... Well, I've done many things, and it's one of the many things that I have done to fiddle with my settings in-game.
Weird.
I know. Like, recently I was still a little bit... I played some Rhaegar, and I got a little bit upset because I still don't like the D control system for Rhaegar compared to the 1. And
he
someone
doesn't
was like,
have a D, right?
Rexar, not Rhaegar.
Ah, right, okay.
There is the ETC pickup. But I was getting a little bit iffy about that, and someone was like, why don't you just rebind that one ability? And I was like, you can't, you can only change quick match, you can only change quick car settings. And someone was like, they just make a whole new hotkey setup for just Rexar, where you just rebind his D to a 1 key.
And then when you play Rexar, you switch profile?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Didn't even think of it. Didn't even cross my mind.
Yeah,
beautiful,
but then it's
people,
like,
beautiful viewers that we have.
You need
here
to change profile every time.
It doesn't matter. I already do it for Vikings.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. Good idea.
Yeah, it's a good idea. If there are certain things that you want to do with a hero that you can't do with others, then new hotkey setup can work for you. So it works for me. I still miss having both the D and the 1, but it's still more comfortable than it was. Karazim to go with the ETC here. So a very aggressive lineup for Ready, Able, Willing.
Yeah, very aggressive. Four kind of melee.
Yeah. I like that you call them kind of melee, because they have two actual melees and then two heroes as a sort of half melee.
Yeah, well, Arthas has ranged too. Greymane can stay ranged. Karazim doesn't necessarily have to attack.
Yeah, he also does have E, which technically makes him ranged.
Yeah. What does he get? 2-3 range, something like that?
I think it's 3 is his range there. It increases the range by 100%, so the question is, did he have 1 or 1.5?
Yeah, or 1.2. I think it's probably 1.5 usually. Could be coding to 3, yeah.
I'll check in game, because the UI that we have, we can actually see exactly what their range is.
It's nice.
If you you have it as well, I believe you're using the Ali one.
Yes.
If you select a hero and hit Control C, it will bring up all of the stats for that hero.
Nice.
Pretty decent. Valor Johanna.
Makes sense. I was thinking Johanna Lunara, but this is fine as well.
Yeah, Valor a bit more, bit of a safer pick than Lunara, I'd say, but Lunara is very much a late game. And there is a cleanse here, so the Chromie is could still go Slowing Sands, and it wouldn't be too bad, and it's still Gul'dan and Valor, not known to be the tankiest of assassins, and Malfurion going to assist with that too.
Well, here's how Fnatic was using Varian with the Warbringer stun and Chromie together.
Yeah.
And they said, we'll stun you with Warbringer, threaten your hero to die and get deleted. You use cleanse, then we temporal loop for the easy peasy free kill. Same thing here. We've got Howling Blast Arthas, ETC with Power Slide, and temporal loop Chromie. There's plenty of things to bait out, a cleanse, and you only have it once. So I like the Chromie. It is somehow turned into a Tomb of the Spider Queen pick, where I would have advocated half a year ago that she's one of the worst picks here. She
has super long range, and this is a short range map.
Someone just released data that she has the highest win rate on Battlefield of Eternity. Like, how does that even make sense? It is the most, again, traditional know-how, the most avoided map for Chromie, because she doesn't have good PvE damage. But I guess pretty nice poke. I thought I knew about the game is wrong.
Like, it makes sense, because where else are the enemy going to be except around their immortal? So I can see the logic behind it.
And super safe Dragon's Eye poke, I guess.
Yeah. So for now, Grubby, would you like to introduce our team on the left?
I'd love to. Ready, able, willing. In the blue, it's going to be Ayre on Greymane. Last Hope on Arthas. Monster Bear on Karazim. Dreamshock on ETC. And Cheki on Chromie.
Whereas on the right-hand side, it is going to be 4K MMR average. We have Cronus on Malfurion, Roskmeg on Johanna, YellowFlash on Ragnaros, Tix on Gul'dan, and Shift playing Valor. And look at those stacks. We have Pursuit of Flame, Sulfurous Hungers, and Regen Master. If Mouth still had his mana talent, the Conjurer's Pursuit, then we could set it all up.
Oh man, he had Conjurers.
He did used to, yeah.
Lol.
Yeah. Not anymore, though. We're seeing a little bit of healing dropped onto Roskbeck here as he tries to wade through. Ironskin already dropped here, so he's kind of in trouble. Gets picked up, and that is first blood going over to Ready, Able, Willing, showing that aggression right out of the gate.
You know, it's funny because I used to lose all the time with Johanna. Now I'm pretty decent at her. And one of the things I did was thinking that because I have Ironskin, I'm invincible. And by the way, YellowFlash is also not invincible. He dies here. One of the things I would do on Tomb of the Spider Queen, I would move directly in the middle of the mid wave, even if there's five people there, thinking that whatever support there is with my trait, I can move in and move out with impunity and not die. And as Roskmeg did that, I was like, I had a PTSD of a million times dying just like that. And I thought, apparently you can do it if you're Roskmeg, if you're part of 4K MMR average. And it just turns out.
As a reminder here, Iron Skin, the unstoppable part of it only works while the shield is active. So the best counter to Iron Skin is to kill the shield as quick as possible, and that will disable the unstoppable. In this case, he doesn't seem to care. He just walks in because the enemy team's already rotating. He feels safe, and Tix is already holding up the top lane.
I mean, you got a lot of stacks from it on Pursuit of Flame, but it's not really a stack that you need to rush. I feel like you'll get it eventually, and it doesn't really matter for the rest. Like, it's nice if you get it early, but definitely not worth dying for.
Yeah. There are very few talents, I would say, in this game that are worth dying for.
Regen Master.
I guess so. Just like the globes more than all. That's the priority. That's how it works.
I think I'm kind of starting to get why Chromie works here. By the way, YellowFlash dead again. Feels bad, man, for him.
But aggressive rotations. They're not even using the Arthur Spruce. They're just walking into lane and murdering him straight up.
Yeah. Nice job by Ready Able Willing. Three takedowns to one. But I'm kind of starting to get why Chromie works here. The gems. Every time someone picks up the gems, you have a 1 second warning as Chromie where they're going to be.
Yeah, that's true. You have that little lovely extra vision thanks to that Time Walker's pursuit. And then you can obviously interrupt from very long range, don't have to put yourself in danger.
I don't mean the interruption of the paying. I mean, when people pick up gems, that's 2 free shots every time.
Tix gets free shotted. With all three of her abilities, with the Q, the W, and the auto attack with bronze talents, which are counting as an ability because it chunks. But Seki, in good position, able to continue his poke and continue working heroes down. And YellowFlash, oh dear, this seems familiar. There's the root this time, and down he goes.
Oops.
Yeah, oh dear. This is a YellowFlash. This is the kind of style you'd see in Hero League, where you'd recognize a player as someone who doesn't handle losing very well, and you're like, let's kill this player and not try to tilt them.
Yeah, exactly.
We know YellowFlash. YellowFlash is not one of those players. He will hopefully be able to deal with this in his head and keep his head in the game.
You would hope so, but it's happened the same time 3 times. And so he was unable to accept losing experience on a pushed lane. And I don't know why he pushed the lane. I guess I know why. He wanted to get Sephiroth's Hungers up. Look at that. 3 stacks on Sephiroth's Hungers. So without attacking the lane, you can't stack it. And so that means that Ragnaros, to a degree, will always be pushing the lane, which means he's always exposed. So he has to be very aware of the minimap, but he just has not been able to be on point with that.
Yeah, this is crazily interestingly played by Ready Able Willing. Oh, bit of an engage. Another kill. 6-1. Currently in like, favor of Ready Able Willing.
It's just like Hero League, man. You keep pinging your allies. Danger. Enemies approaching. Watch out. Stay by behind the gate. And just every time you just... It's that feeling when you're like Team League and you're all plat. And, you know, maybe you and your buddy are like Grandmaster and you're up against 5 Grandmaster. And it's just like, oh man, like I know these guys are going to get picked off behind the gate every time. And... It's to be honest, it should not be happening here, but it is. Well done by Ready Able Willing, of course, but the opportunity has to be given as well.
Yeah, rough. Also, I just checked because we said we would. Karazhan starts with 1.8 attack range.
Oh, so it goes to 3.6. More than previous.
Yeah, 3.5, apparently. It's just rounded up.
Bye-bye,
Valor. Chromie showing once again why she's so valuable on this map.
Yeah, well, that was a Dragon's Eye hit. That was perfect center as well on Dragon's Breath. 25% more damage.
Yeah,
shifting stance is huge as well, controlling the entire gate.
It's a great zoning ability, and it's being used to good effect because Kirby got it at level 8. Thanks to her trait, she gets talents 2 levels earlier. And wow, this is some insane play by Ready Able Willing. They're showing that they are a team to be feared. We already, like I said yesterday, we saw them in Kings of the Storm take games off of Fnatic. But this is still insanely well played.
2 level lead here for Ready Able Willing. They have most of the gems they need, about 5 more minion waves.
They have their heroics, which they've just finished picking. Mosh Pit, go for the throat, even more all in. Divine Palm as a slight counter to if they get countered on their all-in, an Army of the Dead. Not that all-in.
We have to see a very passive play here by 4k MMR average. The standard play would be maybe to get the Bruiser Camp, as it's just not safe being out there in the big bad world. They try to make a play for Grey Main, but the flank of ETC is too threatening and they move back.
This is a pretty interesting game. 4k MMR average, like you said, having to play safe. And look again, once again, that shifting sand completely zoning out everyone. Rosberg starts to wade through him. What's he going to achieve with this? He just walks through, gets a slight harassment on the Dream Shock. Last hope, not even caring. He just continues to take that Bruiser Camp.
Yeah, well, they can take that. It's quite bullying. But, you know, you're going to push your weight around when you've got 6 talents ahead of your opponent.
So, we're seeing a little bit of a work down in terms of structures very quickly by Ready, Able, Willing. They're in a dominant position, get another turn in, and this is where this map starts to snowball. If you can chain those turn-ins well enough, then it becomes very hard for your opponents to make a comeback. However, levels currently, talents are even, and they're not too far behind, so this is still doable by 4K MMR. Now that they have the heroics as well, Horrify, Raid of Vengeance, Sulfurous Smash, Twilight Dream, and Blessed Shield, they have a lot of lockdown.
Alright. Pushing in now to get additional forts. We see the flank here. 4K MMR average is bruising for a fight. They want to make something happen. At the same time, they can't really. Because of the staggeredness of the Webweavers, one arrives, the other one is about to arrive, and the third one will hit after that. If they embroil themselves in a if they embroil themselves in a fight now, they will stand to lose much. So even if it's the perfect level window for 4K MMR average, it's the imperfect objective window, and that's why they're in such a terrible position. And Ready, Able, Willing is fully controlling this game.
They really are. Dragon's Eye being used on the fountain there, beginning to burst that down too. Takes a huge chunk of damage. Shifting Sand still in the gate here, and it can be dropped down here as well. Continued the harassment onto this bottom lane. Not being used yet, chunking YellowFlash. YellowFlash is having a rough game. He is being bullied.
Yeah. Well, he's almost got Sephiroth's Hungers. Though, being a melee spell, it's going to be hard for him to use it. He's up against ETC, yeah. Greymane, Chromie, Arthas, such a powerful deletion comp here. So much control.
Karazim with 6 cents as it's level 13, giving those block stacks if he is stunned or rooted, so he can get a decent amount of self-sustain. So pretty much everyone, it seems, has gone for aggressive styles except for Karazim, who's gone for a lot of self-sustain.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the turn-in has been done by 4K MMR average. They still have 3 keeps, so if they can somehow squeeze their way to level 13, they have a fighting chance.
Yeah, they need to just get as much XP in as possible, because they do still have a lot of gems saved up. If they can get something out of this, they can maybe try and pressure another turn in, and then that can be their way back into this game. They're staying very grouped, except for Rag, which is dangerous, but his team are near enough to him that they could react as long as they were quick enough.
They want Greymane, but the flank, it's not good enough. Oh, wow, okay. It's good enough.
Damage, heroics burn. And that was every heroic but one used to kill one Greymane. But that does mean they can now push
come
in
on, Gul'dan.
4 versus 5.
Gul'dan, why didn't you use it? that was a really good move. Max distance root and blessed shield with the lockdown. Sephiroth smash, Rain of Vengeance. Rain is back. It has 2 charges. And Horrify is still available. It's exactly what they needed. It's very okay to use several heroics if it gives you such a good position as this. Look at this. That fort is going to go down. They're suddenly only a level down. And they're suddenly only 2 forts down. Very good job here by 4K MMR average.
Yeah, they're pushing in here. They're going to be able to take down this fort, but only one fort for this turn in. However, gem-wise, they're looking very good. They have a very lovely collection. Don't think it's enough for another turn in, if my math is correct, which it almost certainly isn't.
I think it is enough. There we go, 66 out of 55.
So they can move in and attempt another turn in here, but now everyone has returned to life. Rosbeck wading forward, not having a care in the world. Damage onto ETC.
Oh.
Palm is good this time, though, but all the heroics use this time, even the Horrify, to get him down. They do pick up ETC. Now they need to deal with Arthas, who is in their backline, killing off Shift. Heal is dropped, and down goes Shift, down goes Ticks. And wow, absolutely destroyed there. Rag drops the Molten Core, but it's not going to do anything here. He has to cancel that and get out of dodge before he's closed in on.
Ouch. So you get ETC. Divine Palm was perfect. Very nice job by Monster Bear. These palms are so impressive. But then Arthas found his way to the backline, and boy did he enjoy it.
Yeah, and by finding his way to the backline, he literally just walked just all the way through all of the damage. Jahada was busy around where ETC died, as she was zoning him out when they were able to get the kill. And Arthas, we've shown just how scary he is. He just walks in and messes up your day. Boss taken here by Ready, Able, Willing, and they continue to cement their lead, approaching that level 16 mark.
Yep, suddenly with that, it turns around again. Level 16. Of course, talent for Chromie is already there. Shifting Sand, some spell power. Gonna push in with that boss. They're looking to get the gate here at the very least. Big damage on YellowFlash.
Yeah, Chromie continuing to get value. Cocktail is also fully stacked, so even more poke damage from Ready, Able, Willing. Looking rough, looking difficult here for 4K MMR Average to try and make their comeback. Bragg does not have Molten Core. He already used it in the bot lane, so it won't be available. Arthur's little deep here, but still able to pull back to his team and stay safe. This keep will die. So Furious Smash catches two members, and the Horrify is used. Monster Bear out of position, but he's able to dash to his team. Even with the Twilight Dream, it looks like they may all escape.
Some very nice set of skills. Slightly disjointed by 4K MMR Average. They get the Sulfurous Smash follow-up on Blessed Shield. He wasn't sure if he should use it or not. They do save the keep, so that is their earnings. But when you look at the heroics here for Ready, Able, Willing, they're ready to re-engage. They're almost
ready,
paid.
Ready, Able, Willing burned one heroic through that entire escape there, if you exclude the Summoning Sands, whereas 4K MMR Average burned all of them to not get a kill. All they did was save their keep.
Yeah. Well, it's worth something. 40% on the keep left.
Yeah. Like, keep the keeps alive is great, but not getting the kill for all five of your heroics, that's not going to feel good. It was a good escape by Ready, Able, Willing as they begin to work down this bruiser. Not even attempting to take their own. Last Hope moving in to turn in his 23 gems, which are 22, sorry. Not enough for a full turn in, but it gets them close. They do have enough in their repertoire once they can begin to get those in.
We have enough gems and they are being paid. There we go. In a few seconds, we'll have more Web Weaver summoned here for Ready, Able, Willing, just as 4K MMR Average can fight. Now, a fight. Oh, Rosbeck! Wow! Wait, who didn't pay?
Well, they all had like one or two gems, so I don't know. One of them could have paid and probably made it.
I think
Rosbeck got the turn in.
Yeah, wow. Very important, actually, because that would have almost certainly killed a keep here for 4K MMR Average. This is the chance of a lifetime here for 4K MMR Average, speaking in terms of the game.
Well, let's see if they can do it. They're beginning to move their way in here. They have everyone alive, and they have all their heroics this time. There's the Blessed Shield and the Sulfurous. They want to try and get Karazim. Palms used and not triggered. That's actually pretty decent. Karazim have been forced back here, and that guarantees that the four Ragnaros finds a time trap. Yes. But they're still going to be able to keep going with this.
It's a pretty big deal. He has Cleansing Touch to save people from silence, but he can no longer play aggressively himself, as Twilight Dream, Horrify could be too good on him. So, decent usage. Both Blessed Shield and Sulfurous Smash are pretty short cooldown heroics, but we can see the Divine Bomb is likewise.
Yep, 27 seconds for that to return. Same with Sulfurous Smash, so those will be available at about the same time again. Gul'dan, fully stacked. In fact, everyone who has a quest talent in this game, except for Arthas, is fully stacked on it. Arthas only 83 on his Frozen Waste stacks. And we're seeing 4K MMR Average putting some pressure onto that top lane, but the Web Weaver will drop. They've finally taken down all the forts, and structure-wise, they've actually evened it up. XP-wise, they've evened it up. The only difference being that huge huge keep health drop that they have in the top lane.
Let's take a look at the damage numbers here. See who has been putting out the most. Chromie putting out the most damage. 34,000 damage from Chromie. We have 31,000 on Gul'dan. And middling numbers for Greymane, Vala, and Ragnaros. Karazim, despite the damage build, unable to, of course, get too close because of all the lockdown. Well, hold that thought. We have a big warrior versus warrior engagement here. Chromie hits the massive numbers on YellowFlash. Only two gems needs to be paid, and they're going to get exactly that. Web Weavers to Ready, Able, Willing.
And that's going to be rough for 4K MMR Average. They need to put some pressure onto the top lane, but they can't get to that Web Weaver because their lane's so pushed up, they're not going to be able to defend it. Luckily, that means it will drop into health significantly before it gets anywhere that would threaten that top four.
Blessed Shield.
Blessed Shield again. Sulfurous lands. This time they're going for it. Palm. Nope, he survives.
All right, so Twilight Dream was just a little bit too late. I feel like he took one or two steps after he got in range and then cast it, which meant Palm actually got triggered, which just makes a world of difference. If Karazim is dead, every Gul'dan poke damage becomes a really big issue. But now, with him casting Palm, Twilight Dream is going to be away for a while. So this is a really huge deal. It was a nice attempt, but just slightly out of sync. Nice vault, but Malph is dead.
Ooh, He was able to fit in an ice block somehow. I think Dreamshot cancelled his mosh pit. Try again, he still went down. But that was very interesting to see there. So now with Mouth down, this is a rough defense for 4KMR, and it was already going to be difficult. Molten Core is available. We're going to see Rag use it here to defend Molten Swing. Not going to be able to get any kills out of this. This is simply to protect the keep. They've already cleared top, so now it's all focused on this mid lane keep. They're going to try and poke in with ticks as much as they can, but the damage output is huge. Mid keep will maybe not fall out. He's a Furious. Beautiful keep goes down. Arthur survives. They turn it around, try to grab someone. Last Hope barely survives with 100 hit points. Greymay gets a reset, though, and gets two kills. He's focused down by Roskmeg with the extra roll. He escapes, and that is a keep and three kills for Ready Able Willing.
My god, that was so well played by Ready Able Willing. Greymane double deleting people on the backline. From Arthur staying alive, the insane Divine Palm by Monster Bear. Very, very impressive. Two keeps just alive with almost nothing at all as one keep goes down. We are once again in that situation that we saw last series as well. Or well played, not me, trying to hard engage level 20 versus 20 as they lost all their keeps. It's not much better off for 4K MMR average. They're going to go up against the boss with nothing to defend and no level 20. Very tough.
Yep. Molten Core not available for quite a long time. 52 seconds already got that, so that's not available. This keep is basically gone. And with no health on the bot keep either, this is going to be a triple lane of catapults that they will have to deal with sooner or later. All they have to do at this point, because they know they're going to lose. Okay, what I was going to say is all they have to do is to not die, but there goes Valor. We're seeing Roskmeg try to tank through this, doing some help for his team. The good Twilight Dreamer, Kronos, is so far away from his team. He's escaping, though, thanks to the root. Tix is ticked down. Mosh pit's dropped. Rag taken out. The tour bus even used. Now it is Roskmeg and Malfuro, who's too far away, trying to defend the core versus five members. This is going to be GG, Grubby. And Ready Able Willing will take game number one.
Very nice job by them. Great team fighting. Excellent Divine Palms. Karma team never died. He saved everyone. Always on time. And, you know, a very rough start by 4K MMR average. Got repaired into an almost turnaround, but not quite. Victory 1-0 to Ready Able Willing.
Indeed. I'm just looking at the like post-game stats here, and three deaths total on the side of Ready Able Willing. Two on ETC on the front line, basically, when he tried to dive deep and get some good engagements. And those were a couple kills. Exactly what I said. And Greymane once when he went too deep.
Yeah, I'm looking at that as well. Talents-wise, not too big surprises. Chromie with the Q build at 16 and 20.
Invited to lobby, by the way.
Nice.
It's going to be Cursed Hollow as game number two. So, the most standard of standard maps.
By the way, a PSA to the chat. Chromie has a level 2 talent called Bronze Talents. She can cast her Sandblast every 2.5 seconds, and it boosts her auto attack, the next auto attack, by about 3 times. So, it's worth casting Sandblast on nothing, like a blank, just to do extra PvE damage on the boss, on other things. And it's a very popular Twitch meme by now to pretend to be the smart Alec, the smart ass, who teaches the streamer or his fellow watchers, why is he sandblasting on the boss? It doesn't do anything. And then the other ones are, oh, well, it's because of bronze talents. That's how it works. And then by now it's a meme. So don't fall for it.
Do not feed the memers.
Do not feed the memes.
Yeah, it is 250. It's 250 extra damage, and also increases the range, percent. I believe, by 30%?
Her base range. Even the weak base range is increased.
Yeah, that's it. The 30% increase, and of course there is still some more HGC. There is a week 6 to 10, I believe, to play before the Crucible. So it's Genius and Synergy have a good chance of winning their way out of those bottom two slots and avoiding relegation. But ladies and gentlemen, it is time for game number two between Ready Able Willing and 4K MMR Average. Falstad and Tassadar banned out.
Yep. Tassadar always the first ban, pretty much, except if you want to have a very tough game where you can kill almost nobody. He did get some nerfs in today's patch. Now keep in mind, today's patch announcement, which we got word of about an hour ago, Of course, not yet live. We are on a Tuesday today. North America should maybe get it today sometime. Around noon of PST, maybe. But Europe always gets it a day later, somewhere tonight, way after midnight. And we do always play on live patch for HGC Open Division. But it is not yet live on Europe. So Tassara gets massive nerfs later, I heard. But not yet.
I haven't looked at them exactly, but I do believe they are probably nerfs, considering he is permabanned. If they were buffs, I would be confused.
Let's see. Shorter duration shield.
Okay. Less
cool. Archon damage.
Okay.
More base life leech on shield, but it goes from 8 to 5 seconds. Less splash damage on Archon. More shields from his level 1 talent. Life leech better at level 4 as well, but keep in mind again, it's a 5 second shield instead of an 8 second shield. And yeah, that's about it. So it's mostly just the duration of plasma shield that has been nerfed. Grant us a bit of Archon damage less. Not as big as I thought. I would say he's still very good, but that's actually a pretty huge deal, I guess, the shields.
Yeah, it's a pretty big deal. So they've definitely changed a lot of the stuff that he's prioritized for, but increasing the life leech on shield, I kind of like. It's sort of a... It fits him a little more niche space as opposed to I can shield everything and just fit into every comp. Excuse me.
Yes,
yeah, I like that.
Very much so. Nazebo on Cursed Hollow is interesting.
He's good on every map, but it's not his most common map we see him on. With Mouth, though, combos well, good damage output. Against Greymane, he is ever so slightly squishy.
Yeah, you know, before Nazebo reached the recent God tier, where he's allowed to pick in first and second rotation, at least in Europe metagame, it was advised not to pick Nazebo versus certain melee assassins. I advise it anyway. Not against Illidan, yeah. Kerrigan, and Greymane, and Sonya. Sonya uses Whirlwind to heal on zombies. Greymane can use... what's it called? Dark Flight to jump on zombies to become Worgen and then queue through it. So it becomes a mobility thing for him and escape. Kerrigan can use Ravage to heal up and jump around and get shields on the zombies. And Illidan can also use Leap past the zombies, giving him an escape that otherwise might not be available to him. They all use his zombies against him. Now, you could say, don't use Zombie Wall. So, okay, maybe. But then it's not ideal, right? So, Nazebo against Greymane is an interesting choice.
There's very few heroes who actually... Ooh, an Amethyst ban. There's very few heroes who actually can get through Zombie Wall. It's a specially programmed ability where basically a lot of heroes who have dashes that could pass through minions, for example, won't pass through Zombie Walls. Greymane's Q won't go through it, but Illidan jumps over it. Same with Kerrigan's Ravage, etc. And Darkflight can jump out of it, I believe.
Yes, I think so too. I think you can Worgen through it as well because it ignores collision. It's designed to cleave everything that you would travel through. So it is very much a thank you for Grammy.
I think the rule is if you can't pass through terrain with the ability, it won't allow you to pass through zombie wall.
So you... but maybe
so
you
I don't
kill
think
it all.
Worgen, I don't think the Razor Swipe would allow you to go through.
What if you kill them all with the damage?
If you kill them all, then yeah, you can you can pass through. So yeah, that will work. Nubrak Arthas covering their bases there. Ability, power, resistance, and some auto attack resistance.
Very clever. Twilight Dream doesn't hurt him as much. Nazebo damage doesn't hurt him as much. Great choices. And a nice diving team by 4k MMR average. Their final hero could even be Zeratul. I think it would be pretty okay, actually.
That would be interesting. I would have loved to have seen Abathur as their last hero, but it is banned out. A very solid ban by Ready Able Willing there. Denying that away. So what do we see for Ready Able Willing? They still need a second tank because Dahaka will not be able to sustain against Greymane and another damage dealer. And probably some more sustained damage. This could be in the form of a melee hero, like maybe Ragnaros if they want to go a bit more burst, or Thrall, something along those lines, or a ranged hero like Valor.
I think you want Muradin.
Lunara.
I think you want Muradin. I don't think ETC can stay alive against this team. Muradin can, and he also has the Thunderclap to slow everyone.
And there it is. Lunara Muradin. Coming
in. ETC is banned too, excuse me.
Yeah. Good reason to not pick him. You were right. You said they shouldn't pick him, and you were right. He's banned. They can't.
But just in terms of going up against mass melee, Arthas is king, and Muradin is second in command. because they both have a lot of area slow and it's difficult to pass them.
So if 4K MMR pick Gul'dan here, we have all of the poison heroes. Like you said, I kind of agree that they're probably going to go with something a bit more burst heavy.
Why would you go Lunara here, though?
It is strange, isn't it?
The wolf eats the deer.
The wolf eats the deer.
We have two wolves.
The poison is the auto attack part of it is slightly disabled by Arthas, and the ability power of it is slightly disabled by Anubarak.
And very
She's
much so.
Sort of
disabled.
Counted on both ends.
Yeah. I mean, it's like Lunara has 20% less spell power when going up against Anubarak. Her damage isn't fast enough for Greymane. Or yeah, Arthas, for that matter. She can go Giant Killer, but can she really stand still against Anubarak and Greymane? Terrible choice, in my opinion. But, you know, they wouldn't do it unless they believed in it. Like, I would say Sergeant Hammer made more sense here. But
Sergeant Hammer would have been a little bit vulnerable in terms of the CC.
Hammer?
Yeah.
I don't know. You put down mines, you never siege up, you only auto-attack. And when you get all in, you concussive blast them back.
True.
She has a bigger health pool than Lunara. She has a 70% speed increase for 4 seconds.
I would actually like to make a case here for Rayna again.
Go, make a case.
Well, in this case, you would have been good for the auto attack, which would have filled in. You wouldn't have been able to. You'd still have a little bit of issues with Arthas, but that's what the Zeebo's for. And he does have a counter CC talent that also reduces the cooldown of his self heal, which would have made him very much more sustainable than Lunara here.
Does it still reduce the cooldown?
Yep. Oh. It knocks back. It doesn't doesn't reduce CC against him, but it knocks heroes back who do try to CC him and reduces the cooldown of his regular heal.
Oh, right. Yeah, that's true. Relentless Leader. And
that's the
he
one.
Could even go putting on a clinic, and every time he kills a beetle, he gets cooldown reduction as well at 7.
Does that work on beetles?
Doesn't it? It's any enemy.
It says minions, doesn't it?
I thought it was enemies, but anyway.
It might be. We'll have to experiment with that later.
I do like the Rainer pick here. Like, whether or not he goes Relentless Leader, that could have been nice. But you know what? Ready, Able, Willing. They won last game in fairly convincing fashion. They're a great team. They've taken games off of Fnatic in other leagues. And I'm willing to see how the Lunara pick plays out. It's definitely fitting the theme of spread damage that started with Nazebo. So let's see how it pans out.
Yeah, we will keep an eye on it, starting off a natural perspective here. The 5-man push in mid lane, not the usual lane we see for pushing towers, but they are going to be able to grab the towers here fairly easily, whereas Ready, Able, Willing have put their focus onto top lane. They're going to be able to grab both towers, so both teams grabbing two towers at the start of the game.
Yep, it's one of those base trade scenarios. The Haka will soak mid, will then burrow bottom, and they're going to send Murd in to replace him in the middle.
Yeah, Muradin whiffing the Storm Bolt there, not getting that perfect Storm stack. So we'll keep an eye on it. And YellowFlash getting a good push down in bot lane already. Anubarak will have missed one minion. I kind of would have liked it if YellowFlash maybe waited and not pushed up, because Anubarak was going to burrow. If he'd waited, two more minions would have died.
Yeah, well, little things, right? But can't matter.
Frost Presence, by the way, for Arthas, going with the triple-tiered quest talent. Probably the only one in the game, I believe, that has that. 5 heroes, 10 heroes, and 20 heroes are the levels for that.
That's funny. I guess you could call it quad-tiered if you consider not making it tier 1.
I guess any quest is double-tiered if you don't complete it.
Yeah. Binary. Yeah. You either get it or you don't.
I guess that's Master's Touch. There we go. We found a binary quest talent. So we have the Widowmakers, of course, for the Zeebo, barely stand there. So pretty much everyone going for usual talents, although we do see something we saw a lot yesterday. Rhaegar sticking with that Lightning Bond. Very much likes that talent on the 4K MMR support.
It's a Kronas special. Let's see how quickly he gets the Siege Gam with that double Lightning Shield. There we go. And Healing Toads as well. You're absolute animal.
Kronas, he is the PvE of this team. He's going to be able to take down the Siege Giant Cap very easily by himself and without taking too much damage. He dropped half mana, but still pretty decent. Whereas Ready, Able, Willing took two heroes, Nazebo and Malfurion, to take that down.
Well, Kronas don't need anybody. He's got his totem. I saw that, Rosmeg.
Yeah, it wasn't able to land it, unfortunately. Nice. Burrow by Last Hope there, keeping himself alive. Both teams fairly even on experience. Slight lead here in favor of Ready, Able, Willing, but nothing significant. That's just due to minion waves not being killed off yet.
Did YellowFlash just do a Howling Blast as he got dragged?
That
was funny. It looked like he was getting dragged and shot out to Howling Blast on his own feet, but I guess it's the whole delay thing.
Yeah,
really
just trying to work out, also trying to gain stacks. He's already 3 stacks in. If he gets 2 more, he would have reached the first part of his quest, which will give him a 2-second cooldown reduction. Nice burrow by Last Hope, denying that. Taking a lot of damage, though, and he will get picked off and become
Lightning
first
bond.
Blood going over to 4k.
That's a Lightning Bond kill.
It is a Lightning Bond kill.
They wouldn't
also,
have got it.
It is more stacks for Frozen Wastes, which Arthur's picked as his level 4.
Murden playing whack-a-mole here with Shift will not allow the tribute acquisition. The Haka will come back soon, and he will have Deep Tunnel available as well. Instantly burrows in. He'll secure this quest.
Denial by YellowFlash, though, gains another stack and forces Mafia into reposition. AR coming in from above. Tix taking huge damage. He's actually getting destroyed here. Barely going to be able to survive. Has to retreat. And you can see how much less damage the poison does. Tix gets destroyed.
He's like, guys, I feel really bad. I feel really bad.
One. Nicely used there. You see Rosmeg having to retreat and go back for mana. Nicely done there by AR.
Okay, so funny thing is that arcane orb from Li Ming wouldn't have reached Mouth. I'm 90% sure, even by the range itself, wouldn't have reached. Additionally, it got blocked by Last Hope.
Yeah.
And also it got him killed. At first it looked like the poison wasn't going to be lethal, but then you had the Lunara, what's it called? Crippling Spores to push another 3 seconds of damage on her, and then also the Noxious Blossom hit Li Ming as well.
Yeah, and he was able to see for that Noxious Blossom. In fact, to the natural perspective he took on level 1 was beautifully played. Maybe in trouble here, though, with Rosmeg and Tix trying to focus him down, but so far Tix not able to land a single ability on AR. AR styling on him here. Unfortunately, he is Lunara. He doesn't have a mount. He just has slightly faster movement speed, so it's going to take him much longer to make his way to bot lane. Bye-bye, Greymane. Last hope with the burrow to stay alive.
Very nice move. He was baiting in Greymane too. He knew that Dream Shock was coming. Great job by them. A very even game, but that was super impactful as they're going to get the second tribute. And it goes straight for the boss.
Yeah, they're going to be able to take this as well. There's not a huge amount of contention. And 4K MMR, they know this. They're instead going to go for their own boss. Pronaz, YellowFlash going to work that down. Lightning Bond going to gain some more value here as Tix begins to burn it down. And yeah, Lightning Bond on this map, I don't disagree with it. Working very well for them.
Bruiser Camp doing some massive damage here in the middle for 4K MMR average. Double boss. Let's talk about how well they can defend. I would expect Greymane normally to Hearthstone and defend the boss. The fact that he's not doing it shows we're right back to our early game shenanigans of full trading base.
Yeah, only this time Ready, Able, Willing already on their way up to the top lane. The Storm Bolt hits a Beetle. They're not able to get maximum value there. Lunara and Malfurion considering going in from behind versus 5 heroes, not ideal. They're instead going to re-wrap around to rejoin up with Dreamshock, and the Zeebo heading his way up as well. Dahaka still pushing this bot lane. Top fort already dead, and that puts good positioning in favor of 4K MMR to try and take this tribute. It won't get them a curse though, so this could in theory be one that Ready, Able, Willing do give up and continue to let Dahaka push, but no, they're instead going to contest it. We're from Dahaka with Dahaka from behind with adaptation, doing some good damage on the Cronus. Dreamshock once again, Stormbolt blocked by Beetles. Twilight Dream only really catching 2 heroes, but Arthas is ancestral here, keeping him alive. Good zombie wall catching 2 heroes, but Li Ming able to teleport out of it. Gargantuan finished. Gargantuan still alive, finally going to get killed by a Beetle. That's a David versus Goliath thing here. Last Hope, rooted, stunned, trying to finish him off. Instead, they turn it onto Meridian. Last Hope escapes. Tix, killed off by poison. And yeah, this Lunara getting value. So, we see able to get the nice kills there. We see sort of Leaping Strike being picked here by Lunara. Both bosses finally dying, and that is a curse. Going over to Ready, Able, Willing. Able to get control of this fight. And they're going to be pushing in here. Really nice damage by Lunara to gain control. Missing 4K MMR. Really stuck in their base. Trying to get control. And having to clear up the lanes as quick as they can. Li Ming poking down in the mid lane, trying to deny this, but a good engage coming in here by Ready, Able, Willing, trying to catch something, but Arcus able to pull back and regain his own safety.
Okay, so Curse has been activated indeed, and big result so far, getting the triple forwards. Now 4k MMR average is trying to defend it once again, but not easy for them.
Yeah, so far this Lunara has impressed us both. It's been able to get some good value here. He did take the Wild Vigor, that extra attack damage, 50% extra for the next 4 basic attacks, which gives him a lot of damage output, and so far he's just been using it to ruin Li Ming's day.
Yeah, and it also gets stored indefinitely, so you can use it at some point while you're PvEing, start the fight with 4 crits, activate it again, and then get another 4 crits, so you can have 8 in a row.
Ooh, nice dodge by Tix there, dodging out the Storm Bolt, nice through onto Muradin, and Tix seems to have been struggling with a lot of his arcade missiles here, not been landing as many as he could. It is hard on Li Ming, it's a very difficult ability to hit, but still, he would have very much liked to be getting more to increase that damage output.
Okay, and, massive result.
Even to counter that, we see Lunara has greater spell shield just to prevent all of that burst damage coming in here. Greymane, by the way, only on 11 stacks of Cocktail, whereas Gazebo fully stacked on Widowmakers, and he has 84 stacks of Voodoo Rituals, so he's still quite away from 20, so he has plenty of time to finish that.
Okay. Game slowing down a bit, where we get the Bruiser Camp and the Siege Camp. We look at the bosses, they're about 1 minute and 30 away. That Bruiser is 350, this one is 2 minutes. So we're going to have a very positive map pressure by Ready, Able, Willing. They're going to be setting up probably to clear the Bruiser Camp as 5. They can still do so safely because the node level 13 has been reached. And furthermore, if we look at the vision here for Ready, Able, Willing, they can see Greymane in the bot. So they know that as long as they stay together, and Arthas is top, as long as they stay together, at worst, they'll be in a 4v3 situation, and that's very comfortable. Now, can I say, let's go kill this hero. They move in on him, and they suspect he'll be pushing along with the wave, but there they
yellow
find
flash.
Him! Yellow Flash!
Got a bead there. There's the Leaping Strike, which does give it a 90-second slow for a short period of time, but Arthas has popped his Icebound Fortitude, keeping him alive. He begins to wade back through, gets the root onto the Dahaka. His team are slowly creeping in. Good burrow. And now Last Hope is body blocked in. Drops the adaptation, trying to keep himself alive. And he actually will pop it. Gets full health back. Ancestral Mounds of Rustmech, keeping him alive through the good route. By Malfurion, preventing any of the damage dealers from following up. The Zeebo killed off by Shift at the bottom of the map. Now it's just the rest of it. Malfurion very low, trying to escape. Rustmech getting the kill there. Now they're chasing through. Dreamshock focus down. He's on the run. The route lands on Dahaka instead, whereas the rest of the team focuses on the Dreamshock. Get the knock up. And Dreamshock will go down. Dahaka was able to borrow to freedom.
So, very good set of moves here by 4k MMR average. They used, you know, they extended just as much as was allowed. They were close enough to each other that they could save Yellow Flash on Arthas. So survivable, this time as Arthas, Icebound Fortitude into Army of the Dead, into Kronos' Cleanse. Kronos once again showing an impeccable level of play. Zero death, just like yesterday, and always there when his team is needed. Lightning Bond, Rhaegaring all the way to victory as 4k MMR average takes it back here. They get a really nice situation, kind of level lead. The boss gets leashed.
That's not good. How far was it? Freddy Able Willing's opportunity to try and at least get rid of some of the pressure, but no, it leashes. They were all playing too safe.
How much HP
and
did
now
it have,
they
the
have
boss?
To only defend this boss.
Did you see how much HP it had when it leashed?
It was just under half.
Ouch.
Yeah, not good. That's devastating for them. So now they're just going to focus on the defense here, burning down that boss in the top lane. And guess where 4k MMR are? They're going to take that boss that just leased. How nice of you to leave it for us.
So I think the advanced play here that few teams ever dare to make is just to do a 3-man attack on towers. I've seen Fnatic do this. It requires an extraordinary sense of understanding of where you're allowed to be when. But the very obvious point would be that 5 people are going to be on the boss. 4k MMR average would rarely invest less than that. And you could probably get the entire wall and then Hearthstone out. It is not without risk, but it could have just given them the edge that they needed to get level 16 and defend this boss more comfortably. However, be that as it may, this is the safe play, the non-risky play. And they're going to be okay. They still have all of their keeps. The Haka is going to split soak. They're going to try and defend this boss, and they do so well. The Zebon and Nara are extremely well suited to this task.
Yeah, and we see Dreamshock not even behind the gate here. He's positioned himself well so that they have a little bit of a sandwich, trying to maybe draw some enemies up. Unfortunately, now that they've pushed so far in, he has to wrap around and help his team here. They're looking to try and pick someone, but remember, this is currently a 4 versus 5. Dahaka, though, has tunneled in very far forward. Look at his positioning on the minimap here. He's wrapping around from behind, looking preferably for Li Ming or Rhaegar. They want to try and pick something up here. Dreamshock pushing forward, last hope from
wave.
Above.
There
looking
we go.
For Grey Maiden. This gets a Nubarak, the root from Arthas, trapping someone. Dreamshock getting some good slows, and Lunara straight from the back. They overtake the Ancestral Sands. They turn it around into Lunara. The Twilight Dream hits three heroes, though. Last hope adaptation will activate here, healing him back up, but shift. Rolling backwards to keep himself alive, dropping huge damage output, and that's going to be a 2-0 in favor of 4K MMR average.
That was incredible. The Calamity Explosion actually gave him a dominant stack and was able to survive through Lunara.
Yeah, he got the Ancestral right afterwards as well, so really helped him out. Beautiful play from 4K MMR average. Despite losing the early game, they've managed to take some incredible team fights and bring themselves back into contention in this game. They get a tribute, bringing them one away from a curse. Now they can start working on the Siege Giants, which they already have with Rhaegar in the bot lane, and there are Bruiser Camps available, which they can grab after they put pressure onto this mid four, which will go down.
Atecha, do you know if there's a way I can follow your camera?
I'm following yours right now, I believe.
But can I follow yours?
Yes, if you know what number observer I am.
And what are you?
No idea. Okay, so do you know, do you have numpad on?
Yes.
Okay, hit the numpad buttons 1 to 5 and find the one that's looking at the farm up at the very top of the map.
Actually nothing happens.
Okay, Alt 1, Alt 2, Alt 3, Alt 4, Alt 5.
Nope.
Not numpad, regular numbers.
Nope. Nothing.
Then no, we're gonna have to pick fiddle with hotkeys. Try turning on numlock and then doing it.
No, that doesn't do it. No. You know, I'm going to just follow, I don't know, I'm going to follow Dreamshock. I have an emergency. I'll be right back.
Okay, yeah, I have found you there. So, grab me a piece of gap for a second and we will cover it here. Nice stun on to Dreamshock. Oh god, if Dreamshock dies, this is not going to be ideal. Sorry, Rosbeck dies. Dreamshock is alive. Rosbeck gets healed up thanks to the Ancestral, pulling back, protecting himself here, keeping himself alive. You can see a little bit of micro around this area. Both teams won this tribute. It won't get a curse for Ready, Able, Willing, but it will put them in a good position to try and grab it a little bit later. Dreamshock wrapping around from behind, finding Yellow Shock here. Gonna stun him up and try and focus him down. The zombie wall is good, zoning out here, whereas the Hulk is in the background, but he gets killed up before the adaptation lands here. And 4K MMR pushing through. The huge damage is onto Arthas, but he's tanking through. Down goes Muradin, and unfortunately, we're now in the main base. I will radio cast it for you. Lunara getting a leaping strike over two heroes, but gets killed off by Arthas as she travels over him. And 4K MMR average able to grab this tribute, and this will be a curse for them. They're going to be able to grab control of that and move into the top lane, which is currently the lowest in terms of fort health, to try and move in for a potential end here. This could be good. So, we're moving in. They're going to try and take down this fort as quick as possible, and they will be able to do so. They grab the keep in the top lane. It is currently a 2 versus 5 defense. They're going to try and kill the Zeebo. That will get the opportunity to end the game. Shift focusing onto Monster Bear, whereas everyone else forces the Zeebo back into base. Dahaka has come back to life. The shield is down on the core. Monster Bear gets taken out, so now it is going to be a 4 versus 5 defense. But with so many heroes left alive, even with shield down on the core, the focus begins onto the second keep. They're going to try and take that down first here, and then maybe move onto the core with 4 heroes alive. Are they going to take the risk? A lot of them are very low on mana here. They focus on the last hope, who pops the adaptation. Storm Shield is dropped onto the 4K MMR average here. The core is starting to be worked down. Crodas dropped low thanks to Lunara. Huge damage output. She turns onto Tix, dropping the poison. The kill, though, Li Ming begins to get resets. AR in full retreat, trying to keep his team alive, but it is too late. That's going to be GG. The sustain from 4K MMR average keeps them alive. And 4K MMR take game number 2. And we'll move... Actually, no, that was game... What game is this? I've completely forgotten. I do not know, because Grubby is still AFK. But I can't remember what game that was. I believe it was game number 2.
No, I had a real-life urgent thing, not a deadly emergency, definitely not, but just someone with an urgent request at the door, and it was not, you know, something had to be taken care of. But everything is good. I'm glad that we were able to solve it, that you were able to take over. Thank you. And we are back. Everything's okay. We are in the third map of this best of three. Infernal Shrines.
Yep. So once again, another standard map. Lots of team fighting. AoE damage very popular here. Tass banned out as the second ban as usual. And Arthas banned as the first one. Saw it used to great effect last game. So, solid ban. He's just very much in the top tiers at the moment.
Thanks for all the energy, chat. Just to show another glimpse of that.
Yeah, thank you, chat.
Yeah, thank you. Enough energy has been granted. We're back. All right. So, yes. Greymane, Tassadar, Arthas. Okay, the usual suspects. Haven't seen Kerrigan, even on Infernal Shrines. Funnily enough, the Reddit researchers who did the monster research, they saw that the stats for Kerrigan on Infernal Shrines are the worst, even though everyone always says it's her best map. Her best map, she has the lowest win rate there, presumably because everyone always says it's her best map, so everyone who doesn't know how to play her takes her there. We don't see her that much.
This is a case with a lot of heroes. You'll find that they have, if you use the stats, they will have win rates lower than what you will see in pro games, because everyone sees those programs or sees those stats and goes, yeah, I'll pick this without any practice or experience, or they'll think that they know better than the pros in terms of abilities to pick.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So apparently Kerrigan on Towers of Doom wins more on the ladder than on Infernal Shrines, which is just a little weird. But
I cast that earlier today. Had a viewer-submitted cast, which was a Kerrigan Stitches game. Which was very fun. Lots of stuns, although Kerrigan, I think, hit about 3 combos total.
Reverse combo,
game.
Probably. stun into pull.
She did try that once. It did not work.
But Ragnaros seems to be the new melee assassin on Infernal Shrines. His power to say halt to the boss, and also poke it from afar in Molten Core, the skeletons, to get some extra shrine minions. And of course, generally just a great bruiser in those small, close quarters.
So it should be good for him. He's also just one of the more solid heroes in the solo lane against a hacker. So he should be able to hold that well. And of course, Molten Core to protect against the Punisher when it actually starts pushing. Going to be very effective indeed. So what are they going to ban? So far, they don't have their own main tank, so banning one out could be a bit risky, although they do get first pick after ban phase, so that could be what they want to go for. Would you say this would be an Abathur, considering it was banned out last time against them?
That's a real Cursed Hollow pick, Abathur.
Yeah.
It's pretty much the only map that we see him very regularly on, and it was also with the threat of a double Greymane on the side of 4k MMR average. Double Greymane on Cursed means free tribute every time. You summon Greymane, jump the backline, you get a tribute. Because they have to kill him or die when they fight against it. But that's not the case here, I think. Abathur Vikings have not been popular on Infernal for quite a long time, because you simply cannot buy enough time. And the objective is just a little bit too good to ignore.
Makes a lot of sense. We also haven't had Garden in the map pool for a very long time, which is why those heroes have also dropped off a little bit. So, Falstad banned out, another global hero. This is still a larger map, so the global heroes do get the value, which is why we see sort of Hacker picked up so quickly. But Falstad fell down a little bit more than I expected.
Yeah, and banning it away, it could indicate that Ready Able Willing is looking to do a bit more of a hard engage style.
Potentially, yeah, attempting to avoid that Mighty Gust, so banning it out could be good there. And to remind people, only 2 heroes aren't allowed, I believe, here, and that's Zarya and Probius.
Why Probius? Not long.
I thought it was 2 weeks. That's the message I got sent by an admin the day before yesterday.
Okay. Well, Anubrak is still an option for Ready, Able, Willing. So far, against Rag, that's okay. Depends what else 4k MMR average is taking. If they go to the route of Kael'thas or Li Ming, Anubrak becomes super popular.
Yeah.
And then that would also explain why Falstad gets banned. Because if Anubrak burrow charges in and you gust at the same time, he's literally alone. because he's unstoppable. He won't get pushed back. It's an isolation. Medivh ETC. That's very spell damage heavy. I think we could see an Uberak here.
It's very spell damage heavy, and it's very setup heavy. They have Leyline, they have Mosh Pit, they have Sulfurous. They still need a ranged damage dealer, so I'm curious to see what they will go with there. But the fact is, like you said, it's probably going to be a spell damage dealer, so a Uberak going to be very appealing for them.
Normally, it would be a Uberak Zarya, I think. Possibly. Yeah. Even though that's triple warrior, it would just be perfect against what they're up against. The extra shields.
Can't do it.
They can't do it. She's banned, so...
Yeah, Tyrael's still available. Extra shields for that case.
But then you really have three relatively low damage-dealing warriors. Zarya just offers a little bit more in that sense. A nuke makes sense.
Yeah, but Grubby, the Tyrael has follow-through. Why would you be short on damage?
It's really good. And he has Nexus Blades, too.
He does have Nexus Blades, but that's slightly more value than follow-through.
Yeah, well, but together they're almost as good as a Power Ranger.
that has been fun on Twitch.
Yeah. Valor pick makes sense, and I kind of like the Nazebo here. Just in general, his damage, control, blah, 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 his late game is great. But also, like, you know that when you take a Uberak, you're forcing the opponent to go for an auto attacker. And auto attackers generally are relatively not super mobile and relatively squishy. If we look at Vala, you know, Tychus, if you land a pot of spiders on them, they go to half life. So really like those two together.
Yeah, it is gonna be effective if they can land it, which they should be able to. The question is, who will come out ahead in this game number three, ladies and gentlemen, of our second semi-finals? And we are loading in to the Infernal Shrines. So, Grubby, would you like to introduce the team on the left?
Yes, the team on the left that just lost the previous game, ready, able, willing, but they're in a 1-1, have done very well for themselves recently, in general, in the European esports scene. It's ready, able, willing, Dreamshock, Ire, Monster Bear, Last Hope, 001, 011, and Checky.
Whereas on the right-hand side, it is going to be 4K MMR average, Kronas on Rhaegar, YellowFlash on the Ragnaros, Shift on the Valor there, Tix on the Medivh, and Roskmeg on ETC.
Last game we saw an immediate tower bum rush by both teams. This time it's a bit more tactical. Very mind-gamey type of gank attempt here by Air and Dreamshock. YellowFlash not sure, actually, about
he
that.
He finds it.
Much safer than in game 1 and 2 with the Spider Queen. Well done.
Indeed. Scouting Meteor, very effective. And YellowFlash taking the long way around, playing even safer there, going all the way the long way up to his lane, where he will be against Dahaka for the solo. Nazebo starting in bot lane a little bit earlier, of course, with Widowmakers at level 1. He's going to be able to gain a couple stacks off of Rhaegar, who wolf forms to try and minimize the amount of stacks those spiders gain.
Kronas with his lightning bond once again.
Yeah, he likes it. The triple man stun from Dreamshock. Zombie wall.
Oh, wow! Dunker.
Whoa! Rhaegar dashing to the outside. Portals through. What a play. Kronas, the 5k MMR average.
Kronas. I thought he was a dead. I thought it was a goner for sure. I did not see that.
Played well.
Wow, nice. And then the portal, of course, to save him.
Good lord. This team just sometimes just pulls off moves where you're like, oh my god, just so good.
Yeah.
YellowFlash in full retreat. This is a familiar situation, but this time he survives. He's prepared this time, and he has already double the amount of stacks that he had in this situation last time.
Yeah, in quadruple the amount of time onto the Spider Queen. So 2-0 YellowFlash so far versus ganks.
Yeah, ETC actually failing to go through the portal, clicking off it accidentally, and as such, Nazebo able to escape.
Okay,
Diff
Vala
might not be so lucky. Greymane coming in, Force of Will is used, Vala vaulting it away, the root is used, the cocktail not able to finish him off, Shift gets out.
By the way, something very funny that happened. Checky threw the spiders on Vala, they were biting her, then she went into the bush, they lost vision, Medivh was still there as well, they lost vision, started going very far to attack a slow totem. So apparently if you go into a bush, well, nice save once again, you can dodge the spider damage as well. Nice little yeah, thing
spiders
to know.
Need spiders need vision. They have their own sight range. It is cool to see. You can juke them. And a flash pulling back, giving a speed boost to attempt to avoid the drag. The knockback from ETC keeps him alive. Heal from Rhaegar. YellowFlash getting chased by AR.
Oh my god.
And he will be able to escape. YellowFlash this time does not want to be denying, and he will not be first blood. Neither team have a kill so far. He either goes to Molten Core to begin the siege and help his team with the objective.
Yeah, very nice saves by Tix over and over. His Medivh play is just insane, especially now with Tassadar always being banned and Zarya not being allowed. Medivh is the number one saving hero from level 1 onwards, not relying on cleanse, instead portals and force of will. So cool to see more Medivh coming in, a real playmaker. And Tix, he plays Medivh on the ladder all the time. So he's got a lot of experience.
A good roll there from Morgan form into human form, getting him out of danger. And it is going to be two kills. Which one died first? Who was first blood? Rag died first. He was the first blood here. Shift getting focused down by AR, but he does die for the trouble. And now Last Hope can be chased down, very low on health. Zombie Wall catches Roskmeg. Only, there we go. Objective is taken by 4k MMR average, but the kill count stays even.
A bit XP ahead for the Dahaka team here in Ready, Able, Willing. But the Punisher does go to 4k MMR average. It's going to jump over. And ooh, portal shenanigans are always a thing on Infernal Shrines. Just two members go in and kill off Malfurion.
The Medivh Rhaegar portal gank. That's something I have not seen before, but they're able to grab it. Now Roskmeg, he's still on the other side. The gate finally goes down. He's able to walk out without having to use the portal again here.
All right, so decent result. One takedown, half the gate, one tower.
Looking good for him. They're looking good. They're in all of the lanes, but once again, XP even. Dahaka able to soak up for his team very nicely here. Was able to keep his team in by tunneling to bot lane very early. Now such both teams with their level 7 Master's Touch for the Medivh, Incendiary Elixir. Pretty standard talents. Not seeing anything out of the ordinary for either team.
True. Now, in terms of the rotations, let's see, what options are there? 4k MMR average, they're choosing to delay the Fallen Bruiser, they get the bottom Impaler, they can push with it, they can take bot, they can invade. Okay, Bruiser taken here for Ready, Able, Willing, so they know they're gonna come from the top left. We have everyone meeting here, Dahaka stays. They're gonna try and exploit that by going for Dahaka. Remember, he's got one burrow, but that's it. Face Melt to isolate him, damage coming out, and there goes the Power Slide. But it's not even nearly enough. And that kind of investment does cost you. It's going to mean you lose your mid lane, you lose your bottom lane. And they could go straight for the tower here.
They don't appear to be, though. Instead of focusing on the mercenary, they already have the one in the mid lane. So that can put some pressure on. And if they can get this one in the bot lane, like you said, those towers could still go down. We may see some pressure coming out of it. We're seeing Medivh still continuing to stay at range, hold the lane, gaining some stacks, building up the Master's Touch, not able to get Monster Bear that time though, so he gets the long cooldown of his Q.
Yeah, so he gets 3 stacks here, 4, 5 stacks. Very thankful for this kind of push. Missed that one. Now, okay, Bruisers are still alive here for 4k MMR average, but it's going to get taken down here. So pretty much no one really gets an edge with the Mercs.
Yeah, no one able to get anything out of that. Krona's actually using his lightning shield on himself there, as opposed to Valor, to get the value out of the lightning bond. But either way, they're still able to get a slight head start, but that's immediately been cancelled out by Ready, Able, Willing moving in. They control here. Dahaka can tunnel down when he is needed. But now, it is a 4 versus 5 while the Impaler's begin to push the bot lane.
Yeah, I guess that's the biggest win here, how long it took to clear and control everything else. Impalers are still there. They do take down the tower soon, and that means level 10 for Ready, Able, Willing.
That was interesting. Cocoon on the 10-second cooldown there. It was taken. He attempted to use it on Tix before he could go into bird form, but the bird form activated just in time. That's actually a 10-second cooldown.
Oh, I didn't know that. So who's he going to use it on? Let's see.
Well, he tried to use it on Medivh earlier. Now he has used it onto the backline, but the mosh pit into the Leylight Seal. Lovely anti-synergy there. The goods of Furious, though. Anubarak tanks through it, though. He's able to escape, and no one has died so far, but we're seeing a lot of damage onto Ragnaros. He portals himself to freedom, though. Every heroic except for Ancestral Healing and Go for the Throat used by both teams there, and no kills acquired.
I wonder how many kills Gargantuan got all throughout the fight. He was there slaying away at Skeleton. 38, 35.
39, 35. 40. Going over to Ready, Able, Willing. Now they want to try and get something else out of it too. Stun does not land. Greymane going deep. They're not able to catch anyone though. And as such, they're going to move back to that mid lane to hacker up to top lane and begin pushing while also soaking top lane.
Okay, let's see how they do this. Nice move by Rossmag. Face smells to wake up the boss. Dodge, Molten Core. Zero siege damage here almost.
Molten Core able to clear that up. Nice and easy. Punisher negated almost in its entirety there. Just get a stun onto Valor on its way out. But in the meantime, Dahaka is still soaking top lane and everyone else moved down to bot lane. There's still an Impaler here. Still going. Spirin could heal that if he wanted to. Instead, for some reason, healed AR, who was at full health.
Yeah, there's some players who will always do it.
Cocoon's used. Can they catch someone from it? It's Medivh. Portal's dropped. Can he get into it? Wow. Ancestral lands and Tix gets out. Nicely done. Crona's finally paying Tix back for all that protection he gave him in the early game.
Yeah, very, very nice payback there. Crona's on point once again. You know what's funny? When you press on Master's Touch, it's sent into on the Haka.
Oh, yeah. How odd. Oh,
well, hit this one for more stacks.
Well, that's actually pretty accurate here. Shift from over the wall does not land the Hungering Arrow there. Instead, just going to poke a multi-shot and the Scouting Drone, giving those Impalers the vision, and that will guarantee them at that fountain. Nicely done.
Okay. Pretty close game here for the third match in the semi-finals.
Bala saved the fountain there. She was able to kill off the Scouting Drone and actually deny the vision. Now Medivh is attempting to help clear his lane. Fountain finally goes down. The Spider's able to finish that off and now chasing down Krodaz for a lot of damage. Good engage onto EDC doing some good damage, but Force of Will forces everyone to disengage. Portal through. Leyline catches two. Can they do anything? The Cocoon used to counteract some of that hard engage from Rag to prevent the Sephiroth Smash follow-up.
Okay, we continue to look for a mosh pit here, but Leyline Seal got used without doing much. Cocoon has been landing on whom? Huh? 10:34. Okay, 10:34 is when the next Punisher phase begins.
Oh!
Begins. No, he's wrong too. Yeah. I wonder if that will draw a comment. It could be like a misinformation mind game.
Maybe. Well, either way, the game sort of tells you, so the team did not have a huge amount of time to react to it. Punisher spawning up here. Dreamshock in position to work, start looking this down, but he's 2v1. As such, pulling back. Vision gained by Tix. He's Monster Bear coming in here. Nazebo below. Greymane able to pick up those Impalers. And Dahaka, guess where he is? Oh, that's right. He's where he always is, pushing top lane.
Yeah, double camp plus Dahaka push. This is... I mean, time is really on the side here for Ready, Able, Willing. The longer they can make this last, the better. They're getting so much value out of all these camps. Especially mid, soon, it's going to do siege damage.
Cocoon on Medivh, he falls off Will's portals, and he's out. Nicely done. So far, the Cocoon has not drawn the kind of kill follow-up that they would like. All heroics for both teams are available now, except for Cocoon and Gary, because Gary is already in the fight, but he's running out of duration. He appears to be distracted by just the world over there.
Alright, Leyline
drops on two. No follow-up available, though, so they're able to just cancel that out. Nicely done. 35 to 29, and once again, Ready, Able, Willing. Going to be able to take the objective here. Now they want to try and get Rossmeg 2, but the portal drops nicely. We will see the escape by 4k MMR average.
Alright, nicely done by Ready, Able, Willing once again. Dahaka straight back to the mid. Impalers are still alive. This is an Arcane Punisher. This is going to do so much damage. Ready, Able, Willing, if they keep hold of this game, and they're winning with Nazebo at level 14, they look so good to take this game. Six forts alive, pushing in. There we go. Do we see a drag tongue? Oh, nice pushback by Rossmeg.
They attempt to pull the Punisher to mid lane, but the Punisher decides that this tower is more important. It's going to work that down. It's still not taking the keep, though. That's actually Dreamshock. Punisher finally moving in. Gets the stun onto ETC, tanking through it, using that Force of Will. No reabsorption available yet. So for now, ETC is dealing with his own sustain and the sustain of Rhaegar, who is currently very far away. Has to use his own knockback to escape here. Keep looks like it may survive here. Last Hope attempting to move in to guarantee it. Cocoon is used onto the backline. Valor trying to clear that up. Keep dropping low adaptation use just to make sure they do guarantee that. Now the question is, can they get out? Leyline is available if they want to try and catch someone. There it goes. Catches two. The Dahaka and the Greymane here. They focus on the Dahaka and he burrows, keeps himself alive for now. And he's knocked out Sulfurous by ETC, but he's still picked up. up here. One kill for Zero right now. Strafe attempting to pick up another. AR taking some damage. Seki dropping some damage as well. And Master Touch fully stacked, dropping huge damage here from Tick. Spiders, though, also doing so in kind. But that is two kills from 4K MMR average. And this seems to be their theme. They start losing objectives, and then the second the enemy team overextends, they turn around and get all the kills.
Yeah, but, you know, that's a great job by them. But to be fair, they did lose their keep. This is an excellent result for Ready, Able, Willing. Everything that happened after getting the keep is kind of a natural consequence of staying there, using a lot of abilities to secure it. Dying there, not the biggest of deals. They lose only two members, fairly mitigated losses compared to what it could have been. They didn't go in a full team wipe here. And it's so cool to see Cocoon coming out here when basically it's been Locust Swarm all day today. And Cocoon, short cooldown, 60 seconds, such a powerful heroic. And this is their answer to deal with Medivh, who normally just makes you feel impotent. Force of Will Porto, it's removing all the targets that you thought you're going to be deleting. And Cocoon on Medivh consistently just really deals with that. Yeah.
It's always been Cocoon on Medivh or Cocoon onto Ragnaros to prevent that Sulfurous Smash follow-up to that Leyline Seal. It's been going well. Very nice use of a slightly more, slightly lesser used heroic.
Another Punisher here at the top. It's going to be not Mortar and not Arcane. What is it again?
Frost.
Wait, or is it Mortar? No, this color is Mortar, right?
Don't know. I can't actually see the color.
Did you know that the shrine has an ability called Spawn Cursed Minion?
I just found that out. I just searched it as well.
I didn't know they were called Cursed Minion. I always called them skeletons. Anyway, good luck, Rossman, getting away. And he did. Probably because of luck.
He was able to escape there. He's still a little bit low, but he's able to heal himself up nicely. He is fully stacked on his Prog Rock, so has a little bit of extra healing. And will be healing his allies as well. Big push in the bot lane. Three catapults down there. And Dahaka joining them. That will probably force Ragnaros, who is already here, to defend aggressively here.
And, yesterday I said two catapults. Hey, look at this kata. Oh, okay. Never mind. They're attacking the Moonwell. But yesterday I said one hero pushing in with catapults doesn't do that much on the core, right? And next time I looked, my core was 50%. So definitely a very big threat.
Yeah, single catapult, two impalers in this core here. Bit of an engage onto ETC, being kept alive though, thanks to Rhaegar. And finally, Dahaka has tunneled up to help his team, so Ragnaros is going to be able to defend this fairly easily on his own now. But once again, this is likely going to be an objective going over to Ready, Able, Willing, 4K MMR, still without Ragnaros here. He's on the way. They can land a good ley line, they might be able to steal.
Well, this is in ladder where you say, ETC, are you ever going to cast Mosh Pit? And of course, it's not that simple. It's too straightforward. This could just be it, but he already used Power Slide. Good. He can't get close enough. The Leyline Seal, unable to pair up with ETC. He gets cocooned as well. YellowFlash takes punishment, but excellent Ancestral. And this is the time for 4K MMR average to turn around. Power Slide is available. Will he make a good Power Slide? Mosh Pit, no, he casted Smelt. Before he casted Mosh Pit.
He wasn't able to get anyone, but he did zone out Seki. They're able to grab two kills and two minions away from the objective being taken. They force Ready, Able, Willing off the objective. They're able to grab that, and they still have time to send someone home to deal with the double catapult lane pushing into their bot, and it's going to be Ragnaros.
Oh, ETC, one mistake there. Using face melt before Mosh secures you to dance alone like no one is watching. But still, it was a zoning Mosh. Nazeebo already got caught. It was a great result for 4K MMR average anyway. And they're pushing in now, destroying the gate. By the way, and a fellow Norwegian here says it's pronounced Ruskmeg. That's a bit too hard for us, so we're going to keep saying Ruskmeg for now.
Yeah, we are unfortunately not from there, and as such, we are uncultured comparatively.
Yes, we are uncultured barbarian Neanderthals. And at least in my case, I'm from Neanderlands.
Ooh, well played. Last hope. Was looking to grab someone there, but he was unable to. Everyone from 4K MMR able to use that portal to escape. Bot lane, even though Rag's been spending some time clearing it, still pushing up very aggressively. There's about to be two catapults in there again in 4K. Full vision of the enemy team, thanks to Ticks. They're going to spend some time clearing mid lane and can then rotate down to grab the impalers in the bot lane, which will take some pressure off. And they're also going to grab some impalers in the mid lane to try and put some pressure onto the mid four so they can take that and boost themselves towards that level 20.
Yeah, and they're well on their way. I wonder what they're going to take for Vala. I guess Farflight Quiver. We've seen one Death Siphon, where she also gets to fire penetrating bolts, which is so much better than bolts that just embed themselves in people's body. You want to go all the way through. And it gives 25% lifesteal to her heroic. Kind of a weird, funky heroic. You don't know exactly how much DPS extra Death Siphon does, but the healing element can be nice. Don't feel like she needs it per se though. Vala, one death, in fact 4k MMR average, has had very few deaths. Thank you, Kronas and Tix on Rhaegar and Medivh.
Oh, cocoon is used. This time, for the first time, there is no one in position to break the cocoon early. Zombie ball used as well, but the portal straight in. Vala is gone. Nicely done. Tix counted.
Oh, wow. Rosmei.
Force of Will Ancestral from so far away. Rosbeck able to stay alive. Leyline catches one. Only the Medivh here. Can they follow it up? No. Instead, it's going to be Anubrak having to tunnel away to get out of danger. And we see 4k MMR beginning to be closed into a choke point. While this is happening, bot lane is pushing, and guess where the Punisher is spawning? It's going to be bot lane as well. If Ready Able Willing could grab this, that's going to be so much pressure onto the core.
Is Rusmate doing this on purpose?
I don't know.
He keeps being in these situations.
He's definitely delaying. The problem is he has no way out. He still have 20. Portal. Thank you, Dix. And again, stunned up. He's still alive.
His supports are like, come on, man.
But while he was doing this, Ragnaros was able to spend some time in the bot lane clearing up a minion wave. And as such, they're now next to a lane that is next to them, as opposed to pushed all the way up to their forts, to their core. So they're able to spend more time on the objective. So overall, it was strange, but it worked. Even Ready Able Willing, they're not even attempting to contest this, except they're willing to let it go since they still have even the gate up on this bottom lane. Instead, leaving to Hucker in top lane, getting them XP. They now have 20, so they're able to move in. YellowFlash getting focused down here. Force Will is used. Nice tunnel by Dreamshock. He immediately uses the cocoon to grab some of the mosh pits. Good though, grabbing three members. Sulfurous gets a lot of damage out. Force of Will keeping him alive. Rosbeck pops out of that pops out as well. Leyland Seal only grabbing one. A lot of heroics dropped there, a lot of hustle and bustle, but very little substance. Neither team able to get a kill. This may change though. Rosbeck gets Ancestral. Kronas very low himself, and everyone's getting out again.
Behold, Ragnaros!
Be gone from my realm, insects!
Die, cursed minions!
Damage. He's only 7 away from grabbing the objective, now 5 away, so they're beginning to move in. Because of that huge rag damage, we're going to see Ready, Able, Willing back up from this. And then again, we have to remind that they don't have to stick around here. They have no reason to. They can let this go and defend it at their own fort, as long as they don't get caught out of position and die.
Yeah, they had to because, of course, 32 skeletons already for 4k MMR average, and they have Ragnaros to finish it off. That's a guarantee. Pushing in with the Punisher now. Mortar Punisher, 85%. Top keep is very low.
The Hacker is pushing in mid, though. He's causing some mayhem
Should
over
he
there.
Know?
Well, he can be back. He's not too far away. He's not going to get the key. I think he's attempting to force pause, which isn't going to happen. He needs to be back very quickly. Level 20 is available for both teams here, and Nazebo is fully stacked on his Voodoo Ritual, so he's going to be able to drop some insane damage output. Anubarak gets stunned by the boss, tries to pull it away, takes some huge damage, and nice burrow to dodge out the Sulfurous Smash. That's now gone for an extra 60 seconds.
Multicore available in 14 seconds. They'll be lucky to get a keep and get away with their life here. Of course, they have Portal, but I don't think they can go for the keep.
Yeah, all food is used, but everyone is here this time. They're able to fight around it. Mosh pit in 13 seconds. Leyline becomes... Oh, the Medivh cheats to catch it. Vala is rooted. Anubis to the backline. And the Twilight Dream grabbing two members. They're trying to take that tick, and they do. With Medivh down to so much survivability. God, Rag dropping the multicore, trying to save his team there. Multiswing needs to be used to save Shift. And it is Shift able to escape into the backline. He's going for the Firefight Quiver. He can now continue to drop damage from this backline here. Nazebo doing huge damage. Multiswing once again doing huge damage to Monster Bear in the backline. The YellowFlash being focused down. Good stun onto him there. Everyone else is able to escape, but YellowFlash is surrounded and he will die here. 2 kills to 0.
Whoa! Last hope getting the kill.
Last hope out of nowhere.
Yeah, and the bottom keep is gone, and I don't think it took long enough to finish the other two stragglers, as there's not going to be enough time to actually make it back to the core. I think this is going to be game. It was so well done here by Ready, Able, Willing. The way that they engaged on Vala with the cocoon and then casting silence on Medivh for the one time meant that they could not go to save Vala from that particular all-in. And Medivh went down to that silence. Monster Bear hitting the big ones. Going for the core, 60%. And Kronos left the game.
Yeah, that is going to be GG. And we will see Ready, Able, Willing as the team moving on to the grand finals to play against Team Zealots. What a game. What a series we've had.
Very nice game there. Ready, Able, Willing. They do it. They now earn the right to go up against Team Zealot in the grand finals of today's HGC Europe Open Cup number 5.
We've had some fun games today. That was very good. That kill on Medivh was definitely game-changing. If they hadn't got him during that last chase from Ready, Able, Willing's base, there's a chance that 4K MMR might have been able to survive, but Medivh got slightly caught out, got burst down thanks to some great engaging by a noob, and that was really what turned it. Nicely played.
And when you look at kind of the tendency of the game, there's something to be said for the way that 4K MMR average played it. They had one keep left and one keep at 30%. Okay, they have two keeps left. One of them is at 30%. One was down, so they were behind, and they were pushing with an Arcane Punisher. So their hope was to take down a keep. Once it became apparent that it wasn't possible, that's when they left. And Vala was a little bit too slow to get into portal. She could have tried to get in, actually. Didn't do it, and that led to the game-ending confrontation. Now, if you look at their takedowns until then, 4K MMR average was doing better. So long as they controlled the fight well, weren't getting caught and running away, they were winning most of the fights. But suddenly, you're up against Nazebo level 20, so things might have changed. So I don't fault 4K MMR average now being up against Nazebo 20, you know, Dahaka late game split pressure, to try and end it there. But that's not really what they were doing. They got the keep to 30%. You know, they neither finished it nor left earlier, which would have been safer. And set a trap. So I feel like in terms of the shot call, it was maybe it was not the safest thing to do considering. But I don't think it would have mattered if Ready, Able, Willing didn't turn up the heat really well with their synchronization of skills. Because that was just insane. The cocoon, the twilight dream, all the impales hit, all the burrow charges hit. It was just very well executed by Ready, Able, Willing. And they deserve that advancement. But you know, next time, maybe 4K takes it.
And a reminder that Ready, Able, Willing is a team that isn't even on the standings. These are going to be the first points they have earned. And now they have, at minimum, earned themselves 70 points, which securely puts them in the top 8 during this just one qualifier they've been a part of so far. And if they are able to win against Zealots, it's a big 120 points, which will boost them up significantly.
And $600. Nice little bonus $600. For a day's worth of Heroes of the Storm play, as you do indeed. Raise your points, your standings, your prestige, and get a better seating into the playoff bracket that eventually can see you into Pro Division of HGC Europe. Come here. Come here, Jamie. Wow.
Okay, that was just mean.
That was just great.